Ninth and 10th grade, this is it, your last day of literature, world literature. It's been fun. I really enjoyed going through this. This is the first time using this particular textbook, and I hope you enjoyed it, and we're going to finish it up strong with some nursery rhymes. I made a comment last time about, you know, somebody saying, well, my parents aren't from this country, so therefore I don't know any of these nursery rhymes, and I understand that. Just keep in mind, though, that nursery rhymes still exist here in the United States. If you watch PBS or Nickelodeon or any kids show, like if you're babysitting or something, nursery rhymes come up all the time. I know that my youngest grandson likes watching Bob the Train, and he does nursery rhymes quite often on that show. So they're still around. They're not something that's just back in the old days and just back in the old country. They're still there, and they're still useful for teaching tools. Okay, we're going to pick up again with Old Mother Hubbard, which has a little bit of a historical twist to it. Turns out a lot of these old nursery rhymes, not the newer ones from the 1800s, but the ones going further back, they were often done as parodies or a way to criticize leadership without actually coming out and saying it was critical of leadership. It was just kind of understood that that's what it was. So here we go, Old Mother Hubbard. Old Mother Hubbard went to the cupboard to get her poor dog a bone, but when she came there, the cupboard was bare, and so the poor dog had none. She went to the baker's to buy him some bread, but when she came back, the poor dog was dead. She went to the joiner's to buy him a coffin, but when she came back, the poor dog was laughing. She took a clean dish to get him some tripe, but when she came back, he was smoking his pipe. She went to the hatter's to buy him a hat, but when she came back, he was feeding the cat. She went to the barber's to buy him a wig, but when she came back, he was dancing a jig. She went to the fruiterer's to buy him some fruit, but when she came back, he was playing the flute. She went to the tailor's to buy him a coat, but when she came back, he was riding a goat. She went to the cobbler's to buy him some shoes, but when she came back, he was reading the news. Busy dog. Come on. Go. There we go. She went to the seamstress to buy him some linen, but when she came back, the dog was spinning. She went to the hosier's to buy him some hose, but when she came back, he was dressed in his clothes. The dame made a curtsy, the dog made a bow. The dame said, "Your servant." The dog said, "Bow wow." So we get just from the impression of this, there's a lot of nonsense in this, obviously. It's supposed to be fun and silly and something that you know, kind of chant with kids and play with. Maybe even do some hand motions or, you know, a clapping game or something like that. But let's look at, you know, just if we look at it on the face, we've got a dog whose mistress, you know, the old Mother Hubbard, is bending over backwards to take care of him. Like, this dog seems to be silent but demanding. Did you get that? The dog's not making a lot of demands. The dog's hungry, but the mistress, she's going to the cupboard to get him a bone. She's going to get him clothes. She's going to get him fruit. She's going to get him all kinds of things. He's not actually making any demands. But when she comes back and she's got the next thing, he's on to something else. So it's almost like she can't quite meet his needs as fast as she needs to. And he's already forgotten those original needs and is going on to something else. And at the very end, the dame says, "Your servant." In other words, you're the boss. And the dog says, "Bow wow," which can mean a couple of things, like, "Yes, I am." But also look at the term bow. Bow to me. Yes, you are my servant. Sometimes pet owners feel this way, that the cat or the dog is actually the one running the house. Now, let's look and see what happens when we add human beings to this idea. Let's start with this cardinal. He's the guy in red. Cardinals wear red and white for their clothing. So for a cardinal, you can always pick him out of a crowd. Even Santa Claus is a cardinal because that's what he was originally. And then next to him, we have Henry VIII. We recognize him as probably the most famous king in English history. So Old Mother Hubbard referred to in this rhyme's words allude to the famous Cardinal Wolsey. So he would be Old Mother Hubbard. Cardinal Thomas Wolsey was the most important statesman and churchman of the Tudor history period in 16th century England's 1500s. And he was both statesman, which means he was involved in politics, and churchman, which means he was involved in religion. Not anything unusual in Europe at this time. Most countries had state religions. That means that the state actually controlled religion and vice versa. And it was usually a fight between the two about who was actually supposed to be running things. So Cardinal Wolsey proved to be a faithful servant, but displeased the king, Henry VIII, by failing to facilitate the king's divorce from Queen Catherine of Aragon, who had been his queen of many years. And we actually talked about that in history class. We know about Henry's wanting to get divorced from Catherine of Aragon because she had one daughter and then had a slew of miscarriages afterwards. So sad. And then wanting to get married to Anne Boleyn, all because he really wanted a male heir, because at that time, England still was following Salic law from France, where only the male heir can take over the throne. So the reason for seeking the divorce, and hence the creation of Old Mother Hubbard poem, was to enable him to marry Anne Boleyn, with whom he was passionately in love. In the Old Mother Hubbard song, King Henry is the doggy, and the bone refers to the divorce and not money, as many believe. The cupboard relates to the Catholic Church, although the subsequent divorce arranged by Thomas Cranmer resulted in the break with Rome and the formation of the English Protestant Church, and the demise of Old Mother Hubbard, Cardinal Wolsey. Another rhyme repeatedly relates to Cardinal Wolsey is Little Boy Blue, the idea that he wasn't really paying attention to what was going on and as a result missed a lot of stuff that he could have headed off and kept the Catholic Church in England. So Little Boy Blue is Little Boy Blue, come blow your horn, the sheep's in the meadow, the cow's in the corn. Where's the little boy who looks after the sheep? He's under the haystack, fast asleep. He's sleeping on the job. Okay, next is Little Tommy Tucker. Little Tommy Tucker sings for his supper. What shall we give him? Brown bread and butter. How shall he cut it without a knife? How shall he marry without a wife? So Little Tommy Tucker, referred to in the words of this nursery rhyme, was a colloquial term that was commonly used to describe orphans, Little Tommy Tucker. The orphans were often reduced to begging or singing for their supper. The reference to Little Tommy Tucker marrying and the lack of a wife reflects the difficulty of any orphan being able to marry due to their exceptionally low standing within the community. The first publication date for Little Tommy Tucker is 1829, at a time when we would have seen the very beginnings of the industrial movement. Okay, Simple Simon, fun one. Simple means not too smart, not the brightest, okay? And so Simple Simon would be seen as kind of a stupid person, you know, not too bright up there. You guys will recognize Simple Simon at the very end of this when we talk about a game that was made up dealing with Simple Simon. Ready? So Simple Simon met a pieman going to a fair. Said Simple Simon to the pieman, let me taste your ware. Okay, so it was really common for piemen or people who were selling food on the street to carry trays full of things. And little meat pies were really, really common, especially in England. And so Simple Simon asking for a pie, not unusual, but, you know, he's not buying. He's just saying, let me taste it. Said the pieman to Simple Simon, show me first your penny. Let's see the cash first, kid. Said Simple Simon to the pieman, sir, I have not any. So he's not going to get any pie. Simple Simon went a-fishing for to catch a whale. All the water he had got was in his mother's pail. Simple Simon went to look if plums grew on a thistle. He pricked his fingers very much, which made poor Simon whistle. Think of that sound. He went for water in a sieve, but soon it all fell through. And now poor Simple Simon bid you all adieu. Goodbye. Okay, so all of this is kind of nonsensical. He's doing all these things, and it almost sounds like it's a very small child who's just using their imagination. So he's trying to buy a pie without any food, like the kid who tried to go, he stole his parents' car to come to California to buy a Lamborghini with $3. Yeah, that's a modern day Simple Simon right there. He goes fishing in a bucket of water. He goes to the thorn bushes looking for plums. He tries to get water, but he's using a sieve or a colander with that used to drain water out of food. So he's not the brightest child, okay? So here's the origins. In the days before fast food and convenience stores were invented, food was sold from street sellers from trays of food. A fair was an extremely popular place to sell your ware. Your ware is anything you're selling. The tradition and history of fairs dates back to medieval England. The term adieu, meaning goodbye, is no longer used in the English language, but will never be lost due to rhymes such as Simple Simon. Adieu is actually French. And French had a huge influence on the English language because the English leaders, the kings, the Plantagenets, they all spoke French. So the people who were leading England for a very long time were primarily French speakers. The modern day version of Simple Simon can be found in the song and a game where children have to do exactly what Simple Simon says. Sound familiar? So Simon says it's nonsensical motions, and you have to do exactly what Simple Simon is telling you to do. Okay, Merry, Merry, Quite Contrary. I'll be honest with you, I always heard that Merry, Merry, Quite Contrary was about Queen Mary of Scots, but this one goes back even earlier to Bloody Mary. So let's look through it and then we'll explain it. Merry, Merry, Quite Contrary. That means always arguing. How does your garden grow? With silver bells and cockle shells and pretty maids all in a row. The Mary alluded to in this traditional English nursery hymn is reputed to be Mary Tudor, or Bloody Mary, who was the daughter of King Henry VIII. Queen Mary was a staunch Catholic, and the garden referred to is an allusion to graveyards, which were increasing in size with those who dared to continue to adhere to the Protestant faith, Protestant martyrs. The silver bells and cockle shells referred to in nursery rhyme were colloquialisms for instruments of torture. The silver bells were thumb screws which crushed the thumb between two harsh surfaces by the tightening of a screw. The cockle shells were believed to be instruments of torture which were attached to the genitals. So, ouch. The maids were a device to behead people and called the maiden. It's not the same thing as an Iron Maiden, which had spikes on the inside. It looked like a hollowed out mannequin with spikes on the inside, and then they would just kind of crush people in there. So it's not the same thing. This is a different thing. Beheading a victim was fraught with problems. It could take up to 11 blows to actually sever the head. The victim often resisted and had to be chased around the scaffold. Every time I've seen somebody in a movie portraying someone being led to the scaffold to be beheaded, they're always, such dignity, a silent tear going down their face. But no, sometimes people freaked out and ran. And why wouldn't they? They're about to get their head chopped off, and it's not going to be pretty like it ever is. And it's also not going to be quick. The axes were notoriously dull. It's not like they spend a lot of time on their execution stuff. It's kind of sad, really. But Margaret Pole is the most famous of these people who had to be chased around. She was Countess of Salisbury, did not go willingly to her death. She had to be chased and hacked at by the executioner, which, oh. These problems led to the invention of a mechanical instrument now known as the guillotine, called the maiden, shortened to maids in the Merry, Merry nursery rhyme. The maiden had long been in use in England before Lord Morton, a regent of Scotland during the minority of James VI, had a copy constructed from the maiden which had been used in Halifax in Yorkshire. When James VI, the King of Scotland, is in his minority, that means it's still when he is a very young man and he is actually having his country run by regents. And one of his regents heard about this execution machine, the maiden, and he brought it to Scotland to execute people there who weren't Catholic. That was the whole purpose of it, because remember James the Sixth, who later became James the First in England, he was a Protestant king, and his country was actually run by Protestant leaders who were so anti-Catholic that they put people to death for their faith. So same thing is happening in both countries, and neither of them are right. They're both wrong. Ironically, Lord Morton fell from favor and was the first to experience the maiden in Scotland. So he brought this torture device or this execution device to Scotland. He was the first one to get killed on it. Another form of execution during Mary's reign was being burnt at the stake, a terrible punishment much used during the Spanish Inquisition. They called it an auto da fé, and it was all over Spain and Norway, in Holland. It was just a horrible form of execution, and it was terrifying. And that's one of the reasons it was used by the Inquisition, because it terrorized people. So they wouldn't want to displease the Catholic Church. The English hated the Spanish and dreaded the idea of the Spanish Inquisition. The executions during the reign of Bloody Mary were therefore viewed with greater fear of the Spanish than of the execution themselves. It's interesting to note that the execution during her reign totaled less than 300, an insignificant amount compared to the executions ordered by her father, Henry VIII, which are believed to have numbered in the tens of thousands. And we talked about that in history class as well. But I tend to go more for Elizabeth, who killed over 1,000 people because people were trying to take her throne. Mary killed people for their beliefs. Henry killed people because they displeased him. Okay, yeah. Okay, Tom Tom the Piper's Son. Tom, Tom, the piper's son, stole a pig and away he ran. Tom, the pig was eat and Tom was beat and Tom went roaring down the street. So the origin of Tom, Tom, the piper's son is actually not from Scotland. The words of Tom, Tom, piper's son are not based on a person's Scottish history. You would think piper because of bagpipes. The title piper's son referred to any piper in the English army or navy, the person who actually plays pipes to lead men into battle or to call people on board ship. This nonsense rhyme for children has an obvious moral. The words used in the phrase went roaring down the street are unusual and convey the strength of the beating. The origin of Tom Tom the Piper's Son dates back to the 17th century. But the idea that this child would steal a pig and eat it, you know, you're taking something that belongs to somebody else and destroying it. There's no way to pay it back. So yeah, he got beaten. Okay, Wee Willy Winky. Wee Willy Winky runs through the town, upstairs and downstairs, in his nightgown, tapping at the window, crying at the lock. Are all the children in their beds? It's past 8 o'clock. So Wee Willy Winky was to teach children to associate everyday tasks with their own lives, and we use these kind of rhymes all the time for this purpose. Before the day of the television and internet, great reliance was put upon the town crier to pass on the news and information. You may have watched an old movie where somebody's outside yelling, it's 10 o'clock and all is well. That's the town crier. It's their job to really patrol the streets and make sure that there's no crime being committed, and to also give people a sense of what the actual time is so that they know, you know, when it's time for them. If they go to bed at 8 or if they go to bed at 9, they just need to know what the time is to get the proper amount of sleep. Wee Willy Winky was the children's version of the town crier. The author of the poem was William Miller, so we get an actual author here. And the first publication to the words of Wee Willy Winky was in 1841. I also have heard in the past that Wee Willy Winky was very likely patterned on Diogenes, who is a Greek man who wandered throughout Athens with a candle looking for an honest man. And he walked around in broad daylight with his candle looking for an honest man, because everybody saw him with a lit candle in the daytime. He's like, what are you doing? I'm just looking for someone who's honest. His idea, or the idea being that there's no one who's honest. You can search all you want. You can search in broad daylight with a candle. You're never going to find someone who's truly, truly honest. Okay. Ba-ba black sheep. Great way to teach your kids about taxes. Ba-ba black sheep. Have you any wool? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. 3 bags full. One for the master, one for the dame, one for the little boy who lives down the lane. So the words were to associate wool and wool products with the animal that produces it, a sheep. Yeah, ba, ba, because that's the sound a sheep makes. It's an onomatopoeia. The first grasp of language for a child or baby is to imitate sounds or noises that animals make. Have you ever noticed that with little babies? And parents start teaching them, a doggy says woof, a kitty says meow, a cow says moo. Okay, that's getting them, they're teaching them onomatopoeias because they want the child to start imitating human speech as well. I know, there's an actual pattern in science behind it. Okay. In some of the earlier versions of Baa Baa Black Sheep, the title is actually given as Baa Baa Black Sheep. It's difficult to spell sounds because B-A-B-A. Okay, so why Baa Baa Black Sheep? Let's see. Here we go. The wool industry was critical to the country's economy from the Middle Ages until the 19th century, so it's therefore not surprising that it's celebrated in the Baa Baa Black Sheep nursery rhyme. An historical connection for this rhyme has been suggested, a political satire said to refer to the Plantagenet King Edward I, who is the master, and the export tax imposed on Britain in 1275, in which the English custom statute authorized the king to collect a tax on all exports of wool in every port in the country, which would give him a pile of cash. Further research indicates another possible connection to the nursery rhyme to English history relating to Edward II. The best wool in Europe was produced in England, but cloth workers from Flanders, Bruges, and Lille were better and more skilled in complex finishing trades such as dyeing and fulling. That's the cleansing, shrinking, and thickening of cloth. In fact, Flanders is famous for its wool cloth. King Edward II encouraged Flemish weavers and cloth dyers to improve the quality of final English products. Okay, the earliest date for this is 1744, but let's talk about the taxation issue here. If somebody was a sharecropper or someone was raising sheep and the black sheep, you know, giving up its wool, which sheep need to be sheared. Okay, when they're just left out in the wild, they're their wool becomes unwieldy. They don't shed it. It has to be cut off. So one bag is for the master, the person who actually owns the land of the sheep. The second one is for the dame, who is the master's wife usually. The third one could be for the little boy who lives in the house of the master and the dame, but it's more likely it's the shepherd. That's his pay. Okay. Yankee Doodle. You all know this one, for crying out loud. Yankee Doodle went to town a riding on a pony, stuck a feather in his hat, and called it macaroni. Yankee Doodle, keep it up. Yankee Doodle Dandy. Mind the music and the step, and with the girls be handy. There are many, many more verses. I did not include them. We've heard them before, but let's go through the history of the rhyme. It was written several years before the American Revolution. Yankee Doodle Dandy was universally popular among both the rebels and the British soldiers during the war. In America, the song surfaced during the French and Indian War, when the colonials joined forces with General Braddock at Niagara. The colonials were a motley crew wearing furs and buckskins. British surgeon Richard Shuckburgh, during that war, reportedly substituted new words for the old Cromwell song, changing Nankee to Yankee, making fun of Americans fighting alongside British troops. Legend has it that the song first appeared as a nursery rhyme, ridiculing England's Oliver Cromwell as Yankee Doodle. Oliver Cromwell actually overthrew the King of England, Charles I, took over Parliament himself, became the leader, and then had Charles I beheaded, and then immediately dismissed Parliament and became a dictator. Not a good guy. In the song, Doodle refers to a sorry, trifling fellow, a fool, or a simpleton, so another simple Simon. Dandy, on the other hand, refers to a gentleman of affected manners, dress, and hairstyle, so it's someone who's fabulous. Macaroni was not a reference to the pasta, but it was a fancy style of Italian dress imitated in England at the time. It's actually supposed to be French dress. They put Italian, but macaronis were the big wigs from France. The song expressed in the perception of the British that a colonial could stick a feather in his coonskin cap and think he was as fashionable as any European. The song was a parody proclaiming colonials as country bumpkins. Though the song held them up to ridicule, the colonials adopted the song as their own. That's what Americans do. We just adopt it as part of our culture and go, yeah, we were rough, but that's okay. We're moving on. Countless versions evolved, as many as 190 verses in all. In a display of irony, when the British surrendered their forces at Yorktown to end the war, their band played The World Turned Upside Down. The Americans played Yankee Doodle. We kind of adopted it as an unofficial national anthem right from the very beginning. The colonials may have been an army of ragtag farmers, under-equipped, underclothed, and rarely paid, but they defeated the largest, most powerful army in Europe to gain their freedom. Yay us. Okay, Peace Porridge Hot. If you've ever played the hand clapping game with this, Peas Porridge Hot, it's an old, old game, but it's still around, and it's Peace Pudding Hot. I'm sorry, they did pudding, so because English. Peas pudding hot, peas pudding cold, peas pudding in the pot 9 days old. Some like it hot, some like it cold, some like it in the pot 9 days old. So the peas pudding hot referred to in the words of this poem is a traditional dish which is still used and enjoyed in Britain today. It is a smooth, thick sauce referred to as a pudding in a rhyme for the sake of alliteration, and has a dark yellow color. Peas pudding is a hot dish made from dried peas. It can be reheated as often as required. Peas pudding in the pot 9 days old. Peas pudding is traditionally served hot with boiled bacon or a form of sausage called savelroy. Savelroy. Yeah, I did it right. Okay, Hickory Dickory Dock. This is really popular too. Hickory Dickory Dock. The mouse ran up the clock. The clock struck one. The mouse ran down. Hickory Dickory Dock. A nonsense poem which uses alliteration. That means the words have the same letter, okay, beginning letter. So Dickory Dock is going to be using that alliteration. Where children mimic the sound of a clock chiming at the relevant point in the song. Hickory Dickory Dock is intended to introduce children to the fundamentals of telling time. Hickory Dickory Dock is also known by another title, Hickory Dickory Dock, with just the C. Inevitable, perhaps due to the nonsensical nature of the words of Hickory Dickory Dock. The first publication for Hickory Dickory Dock rhyme is 1744. Investigation into the meanings of the words used in the rhyme lead us to believe that it has its origins in America. Why? Because that's where you find Hickory and Dock. I know. Cool, huh? Hickory is derived from the North American Indian word. That one. Pocahontas? I have no idea. Which is an oily, milk-like liqueur that's pressed from pounded hickory nuts. The word pohickory was contained in a list of Virginia trees published in 1653, and the word pohickory was subsequently shortened to hickory. So this is a hickory tree. Dock is a species of plant which has its Latin name of Rumex crispus, a well-known weed which has a long taproot, making it difficult to exterminate. That means the taproot goes way down in the ground. You have to really pull on it. The dock can be used as an astringent or a tonic, and many of us would have experienced the healing property of the dock leaf after being stung by a stinging nettle. It's also good for sunburn. Okay, Jack Sprat. This is fun. Jack Sprat could eat no fat. His wife could eat no lean. And so betwixt the two of them, they licked the platter clean. So they're on two very different diets. Jack ate all the lean, Joan ate all the fat. The bone, they picked it clean, then gave it to the cat. Jack Sprat was wheeling his wife by the ditch. The barrow turned over, and in she did pitch. Says Jack, "She'll be drowned." But Joan did reply, "I don't think I shall, for the ditch is quite dry." So Jack Sprat, alluded to in this English poem, is reputed to be Charles the First. That is the gentleman on the left, the only gentleman in the picture, and Henrietta Maria, his queen. Apparently, when King Charles, Jack Sprat, declared war on Spain, Parliament refused to finance him, leaving him very lean. So his wife imposed an illegal war tax to get some fat after the angered king dissolved the Parliament. And then he was overthrown later by, really, Cromwell. Remember that? We just talked about it. Another interpretation of the Sprat nursery rhyme relates to the story of Richard the First, or Rich and the Lionheart, and his younger brother, King John, both of whom feature strongly in the traditional legend of Robin Hood. In 1189, John, Jack Sprat, married Joan, the ambitious and greedy daughter and heiress of the Earl of Gloucester. Joan ate all the fat. When King Richard went on crusade from 1190 to 1194, John attempted to take the crown of England, a ruthless and treacherous usurper. On his return from the Crusades, King Richard was taken hostage by Duke Leopold, demanding a ransom of 150,000 marks. John reluctantly had to raise the ransom, leaving the country destitute for years and reducing John's inheritance. They picked it clean. The ransom was paid, and Richard was released. John was crowned the King of England following the death of Richard in 1899. He had his marriage to Joan annulled. She was never acknowledged as queen. She then married again to Geoffrey de Mandeville, and her third husband was Hubert de Burgh. I'm not sure how much of that I'm going to agree with there. I know that Richard was taken hostage, but I don't know about that being completely paid off because he was rescued. Okay, hey, diddle, diddle. Hey, diddle, diddle, the cat and the fiddle. The cow jumped over the moon. The little dog laughed to see such fun, and the dish ran away with a spoon. What in the world does this mean? Probably nothing. It's just really, really silly and fun. Hey, diddle, diddle is a fantasy rhyme. It's designed to delight children with impossible images such as the cow jumped over the moon. Walt Disney's team of animators use this type of imagery in animated films to great effect. The term hey diddle diddle can be found in works of Shakespeare and was a colloquialism used much in the same vein as hey nonny no, which is also nonsense but invented by Shakespeare, which can be found in traditional English folk ballads. The original title was Hi Diddle Diddle, but has been altered to Hey Diddle Diddle over the years with changes to the English language. The first known date of publication for the words Hey Diddle Diddle rhyme, 1765. Shakespeare was an interesting guy. If he didn't have a word that fit just right for his work, he just made one up. A lot of our words that we use in English today were actually invented by Shakespeare. So if you want a really good time, and you're a little bit of a nerd, you can type in words invented by Shakespeare into your search engine, and there will be a huge list that comes up. You'd be shocked how many of the words used today were totally made up by the bard. Three little kittens. I gotta admit, this was one of my favorite nursery rhymes growing up because I had a little book that had the little kittens, and I thought kittens are really cute, and I still do. I still really like kittens, and I wasn't allowed to have a cat because my parents thought they were evil. But yeah, I loved the Three Little Kittens. So I read that book a lot. So here we go. Three little kittens. They lost their mittens and they began to cry. Oh, mother dear, we sadly fear that we have lost our mittens. What? Lost your mittens, you naughty kittens? Then you shall have no pie. Meow, meow, meow. Now we shall have no pie. Three little kittens, they found their mittens, and they began to cry. Oh, mother dear, see here, for we have found our mittens. Put on your mittens, you silly kittens, and you shall have some pie. Meow, meow, meow. Now let us have some pie. The three little kittens put on their mittens, and soon they ate up the pie. Oh, mother dear, we greatly fear that we have soiled our mittens. What soiled your mittens, you naughty kittens? Then they began to cry, meow, 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 and they began to sigh. The three little kittens, they washed their mittens and hung them out to dry. Oh, mother dear, do you not hear that we have washed our mittens? What washed your mittens? You are good kittens. But I smell a rat close by. Meow, 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 we smell a rat close by. Okay, what is being taught here? We got kittens, children, who lose something. Then they find it. Then they wear it at the most inappropriate time, which frankly, I blame the mom for that. Okay. But then they take care of the issue. So in the whole story, you've got problem solving going on, which is a good thing. So these are words directed toward a mother and a child in the common occurrence of losing an article, then finding it, and finally being rewarded. The word meow shows effective use of onomatopoeia, where a word sounds like the action. The mother cat was correct in her view that she could smell a rat. This nursery rhyme first appeared in the only true Mother Goose melodies in 1843. Okay? Humpty Dumpty. I bet most of you have heard this one sometime in your life, but you probably didn't know the origin. So Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. So Humpty Dumpty was a colloquial term used in the 15th century England to describe someone who is obese. Oh, thank you. It has given rise to various but inaccurate theories surrounding the identity of Humpty Dumpty. The image of Humpty Dumpty was made famous by illustrations included in the Alice Through the Looking Glass novel by Lewis Carroll. However, Humpty Dumpty was not a person pilloried in the famous rhyme. There was no actual person called Humpty Dumpty, and it wasn't until Alice Through the Looking Glass that people thought of it as an egg. That was the first time people thought of Humpty Dumpty as an egg. Before that, it was just a nonsense rhyme that very likely had to do with this cannon. Humpty Dumpty was in fact believed to be a large cannon. It was used during the English Civil War. Hey, that's the third time we've gotten the English Civil War. That's when Charles I was overthrown and a new man took over and dismissed Parliament. This is exactly the same period. The Siege of Colchester. Colchester was strongly fortified by the Royalists, those who were in favor of the king, and was laid to siege by the Parliamentarians, the Roundheads, led by Cromwell. In 1648, the town of Colchester was a walled town with a castle and several churches and was protected by the city wall. Standing immediately adjacent to the city wall was St. Mary's Church. That's kind of an important thing to remember. There's a difference between a palace and a castle. A castle is fortified. That means it's an actual fort. It's there for defense. A palace is just a really pretty mansion. A huge cannon, colloquially called, man, they're going to make me say colloquially how many times, called Humpty Dumpty, was strategically placed on the wall next to St. Mary's Church. Historical events detailing the siege of Colchester are well documented, and references to the cannon Humpty Dumpty are as follows. June 15th, 1648, St. Mary's Church is fortified, and a large cannon is placed on the roof, which was fired by One-Eyed Jack Thompson. July 14th and 15th, the Royalist fort within the walls of St. Mary's Church is blown to pieces, and their main cannon battery, Humpty Dumpty, is destroyed. August 25th, 1648, the Royalists lay down their arms, open the gates of Colchester, and surrender to the Parliamentarians. So Humpty Dumpty, because it fell apart, all the king's horses, all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again, and they ended up losing the battle. A shot from a parliamentary cannon succeeded in damaging the wall beneath Humpty Dumpty, which caused the cannon to tumble to the ground. The Royalists or Cavaliers, all the king's men, attempted to raise Humpty Dumpty onto another part of the wall. However, because the cannon or Humpty Dumpty was so heavy, all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. This had a drastic consequence for the Royalists, as the strategically important town of Colchester fell to the Parliamentarians after a siege lasting 11 weeks. The earliest traceable publication is 1810. And then, Alice in Wonderland, good book. That's it for chapter 8. And I'm going to explain chapter 9, and then I'm going to say goodbye to you for the rest of the year. Okay. If we go back to the very beginning of your textbook, and if you can't remember that far back, I gave you a story about a well and how you could go to that well and draw water from it and use it for a variety of purposes. You could use it to water an orange tree, water some cucumbers and tomatoes, to boil on the stove to make hot chocolate or tea. There was a lot of different things you get from that well. And the idea was, when we talk about stories, the one story in literature, it's all there, but writers go to that well and they get something from that one story and they create something brand new, but yet it is always part of that one story. So from creation until today, we have been living that one story from that well. We write it in our term papers, our essays, and our journals. We listen to it in every song. We watch it in every moving picture. We play it with every game. We read it in every nursery rhyme, fairy tale, fable, parable, proverb, adventure story, myth, epic, and every verse of the Bible. So the last book that we were going to do this year is called The Hiding Place by Corrie Ten Boom. Miss Ten Boom was born and raised in Holland. While she was unexceptionally traditionally schooled, she and her family expanded their education through music appreciation, religious instruction, and reading. Corrie Ten Boom became famous for writing about her experiences just before and during World War II. And her autobiography is now part of that one story. So, okay. This is the cover of her book, The Hiding Place. I was actually going to do this lecture yesterday, but I didn't have all the slides illustrated then, so I had to postpone it for one day. I will make sure that this book is available to you in the office next week. If you would like to read it, you may. There is no requirement to read it. We are out of time, but it's a great book. So if you're looking for a really good book to read over the summer, this is an excellent book. If you would like to use the books over the summer, that's fine. Just bring them back the following school year. And if you need to turn in your book, which you should do, turn in your literature book to me so I can grade everything. But if you want to use the reading guide in the book, you can just remove it. You can tear it out. Okay. It's just terrible. You guys know that our books can be torn out. So go ahead and remove that and staple the pages together and pick up one of these books if you would like to read it. I'm inviting you to read this book. It's an excellent book. And it might be a good book, too, if you wanted to borrow more than one copy to have maybe a little reading club or book club with like your mom or sisters or friends and get together and read this book and talk about it. That would be awesome. But that's all up to you. I have told you from the very beginning, from the very first class period, that I expect you to learn how to teach yourselves. Not because you don't need teachers and you don't need school. That is ridiculous. Of course you need that. You need that guidance. You need to get in the right direction. But along with going to school, along with listening to teachers, along with getting that experience in the classroom, you need to take the time to find out what is important to you and what else you can learn. You should be teaching yourself at this point. So this summer, I hope you take the time to continue to learn. Pick up a book, watch a movie, watch a TV show. Think about what you're actually learning from that. Play games, video games, board games, talk with friends, communicate, and get into some deep study on a subject that you really love. It could be science, could be history, could be literature, could be mathematics. It's all there for you. Really explore your favorite subjects and do your best and increase your knowledge. Get that learning in your brain. That's really important to you. So I'm going to say goodbye. I had a blast teaching this class. It was my favorite class this year. I love world literature. I love literature anyway, obviously, because I got this big old library behind me. But I loved our discussions in class. I'm sorry we didn't get to finish at school, but I hope that these lectures were helpful, and I hope that you'll continue on the study. And that's all I have left to say. So from now on, I'll just say goodbye. Thank you.